Welcome to the NTEB Radio Bible Study with your host and Bible teacher, Jeffrey Greider. Rightly divided, dispensationally correct, and standing on the authority of the King James Holy Bible, this program is brought to you by NowTheEndBegins.com.
And good evening, everybody. Happy Sunday, and welcome to this edition of the NTEB Open Forum Question and Answer. We invite you to bring your Bible questions, contradictions, and Bible befuddlement. And we're going to get it all straightened out for you tonight in our open forum. One of the most beloved features we have here at NTEB is when we do the open forum question and answer segment of our regular King James Bible studies. Here, you can ask any question you like on any part of the King James Bible, Old and New Testament. And we'll do our very best to answer those questions. No, this is not Stump the Preacher, but rather a chance for you to get your answers on any part of the Bible that you've always wondered about. On this episode of Rightly Dividing, we are answering your long-simmering Bible questions like, where did Cain get his wife from? Are there any errors in the Bible? Do Christians follow the law of Moses? What precedes the catching away of the church? And just about any other topic you might have always wanted to have an answer to. The Bible is not so much a hard book to understand as it is a hard book to believe. And of course, no answer to any Bible question is true and accurate if it is not rightly divided, according to 2 Timothy 2:15, and dispensationally correct in the light of the writings of the Apostle Paul for the church age. Job 33:5 says, "If thou canst answer me, set thy words in order before me. Stand up." Join us tonight for another exciting NTEB Open Forum Question and Answer King James Bible Study. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for all these that you're gathering here live and for the people who will listen to these programs in the archive. And we ask you to meet with us now, Father God. Lead us and guide us in truth for your name's sake, and we'll give you all the honor and the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, welcome, everybody. Glad that you're here tonight. We are going to do what we were supposed to do, part two on Wednesday night, but we got hurricaned out. And tonight we're going to do part two of our open forum, and we are just so very excited. And already the questions are coming in, and really good questions like, why is Samson in the heroes of the faith? And what about that threshing floor? Was it sold for 600 pieces of gold or 50 pieces of silver? And we're going to look at all that tonight and so much more. So very, very glad that you are here with us. This morning on the Sunday service, I told you that we had already begun to lend a hand to the hurricane victims as the Lord gives us opportunity to do so. And we've already sent $2,500 to Victory Baptist Church. And they are loading up a tractor trailer with hurricane supplies and food, clothing, shelter. We also want to get Bibles down to the people on the west coast of Florida and to South Carolina as well. So we have a lot that we're hoping to do. And if you would like to be part of that relief effort, we invite you to go to NowTheEndBegins.com and just click on any of the donate buttons. And the money will get to the right place. You don't have to worry about that. But if the Lord puts on your heart to pray for our efforts, please do so. And if the Lord puts on your heart to help us financially with these efforts, well, we would be very grateful if you did that, because that's the only way that we can do it. So we will be partnering with various churches in South Florida and in South Carolina. And if you'd like to be a part of that, you are absolutely more than welcome to do so. And at the very least, I hope that you will pray for our efforts and ask the Lord to lead us and guide us as we try to be a blessing to not only the saved people who are devastated after the hurricane, but for the lost people as well. We want to do our best to comfort both sides. And we'll just do what the Lord will let us do. I'm very glad that you are here tonight, and I hope you're looking forward to rousing, rollicking, open forum. This is one of my favorite parts of the program, and I love your questions, and they always make me think. They're always thought-provoking, and I always get excellent feedback the next day. Glad you're here tonight.
In sin I was living, no thought was I giving of dying and where I would go. I was looking and buying, so hard was I trying to gain all this world had to hold. No peace and no pleasure could I even measure with all that I had to gain. I repented and prayed, Christ save me that day. Now I have got something to say. I'm not going to hell. I met the Savior, what a story I tell. I'm saved and forgiven, set free, all is well. I'm not going to hell. No, I'm not going to hell.
Now my life's worth living, since I've been forgiven. Christ made a real change in me. I'm no longer crying when I think about dying, 'cause heaven is waiting for me. Now Satan's still lying, he's always trying to lead you down the wrong way. Just call on Christ's name, he'll save you today. Then look back to Satan and say,
I'm not going to hell. I met the Savior, what a story I tell. I'm saved and forgiven, set free, all is well. Saved and forgiven, set free, all is well. I'm not going to hell. No, I'm not going to hell. Because I'm saved by His power divine.
Yes, I'm saved.
I'm saved to new life sublime. Life now is sweet and my joy is complete, for I'm saved.
Amen. Amen.
I'm not going to hell.
Amen.
Star I am, the breath of all creation, who always was and is to come. I am the one who walked on water. I am the one who calmed the seas. I am the miracles and wonder. So come and see, oh, follow me, and you will know that I am the fount of living water, the risen Son of Man, the healer of the broken. And when you cry, I am your Savior and Redeemer, who bore the sin of man, the author and perfecter, beginning
when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever I love, thou hast taught.
Amen. Let me tell you about something we have at the bookstore. We have a section called Defending the King James Bible. And every month we add new titles to this section. One of the great books in that section is called The Errors in the King James Bible. And the word errors is in quotation marks because there are no errors in the King James Bible. But this book, we have this book and 14 other books in our Defending the King James Bible section, and I just want you guys to go and check it out and see what's available. 15 rock-solid titles. Any one of these books will help you to drastically increase your knowledge and understanding of the King James Bible. 15 really rock-solid books, and you can go to BibleBeliever.com. Just go to the book section and click on the tab that says Defending the KJB. I'm all tongue-tied. Defending the KJB, the King James Bible. And highly recommend the book by Dr. Ruckman called The Errors in the King James Bible. But we also have Gail Ripplinger's New Age Bible Versions, Ruckman's Apocalypse, Bible Version Secrets Exposed, Which Bible Would Jesus Use, Manuscript Evidence, Final Authority, really, really good books. And I highly recommend that you check out our Defending the KJB section, where you will find classic Christian books, commentaries, and study guides to help you to defend the King James Bible against the perverted modern versions. Tonight, if you're just tuning in, we're going to be having another one of our open forums. Lots of great questions already coming in. And just be prepared. Get yourself a cup of coffee or chai tea or herbal tea or Tetley's tea or coffee, apple juice, whatever you want. Just get ready to turn lots and lots and lots of pages tonight. Somebody said one time about our programs that it was a pretty good program if we would just have less Bible references. And nope, we are never going to do that. We love comparing Scripture with Scripture. We love going Old Testament, New Testament. And no, we are not bound to Romans to Philemon only. That is hyper-dispensationalist nonsense. You can find church-age doctrine just about everywhere you go. You just have to apply 2 Timothy 2:15, and we're going to be getting started with part two of our NTEB Open Forum question and answer in just about 7 minutes.
But at the grave, something
Amen. Amen.
And there he comes, and he's got the blood that he shed on Calvary. And the Father says, well done, my son. This is the last blood I'll ever need.
To die on a cross for crimes he had done. The thief was guilty, everyone could see. But his destiny was changed as he looked at Christ and said, when your kingdom comes, remember me. Said, friend, how did you come? What are the deeds you have done? With tears in his eyes, I can hear him reply. There are no merits to my name, no works that I can claim. He who brought me here told me to.
I could not find my way until this glorious light of love shone down on me. His mercy washed all my sin away.
And what he did for me that day was a price I know he paid. By his grace I too can say,
it's the suffering of God.
Heavenly Father, we come before you and we commit this time to you. Tonight we pray for Charlton's brother Martin, who is in the ICU and he needs our prayers. Charlton sent me an update. Let me just pull that up real fast. Martin is in fairly tough shape, and it's really come as a surprise to a lot of people in Charlton's family. And let me just pull up the update that he sent me. Have about 8 trillion windows open right now. And he said, just found out that Martin started the medication for severe psoriasis as of May of this year. And it's something that can cause liver damage. And he took the vaccine. And he said alcohol consumption is a factor as well. And he said, I'm at the hospital, and man, oh man, he is hooked up to quite a few machines. So we're praying for Charlton's brother Martin, that God would give him a healing and a recovery. Laura Campoy was in a very serious motor scooter accident, and she's going to need a lot of rehabilitation. We're praying for Annetta, who needs prayers for a complete healing to walk again after a stroke back in May. Kevin Thompson is asking prayers for guidance on a possible move in November. Robert Wiley is battling ALS disease, and he just wants to be there to support his wife. But outside of that, he says he is ready to go home. Sandy Thomas is asking the Lord to rule and overrule regarding her deceased husband's Social Security account. Bianca would like prayers for husband Derek and for their marriage. Raquel would like prayers for her 11-year-old son with an eating disorder. Rosilla Papp, she lives in Southwest Florida, and she is grateful that she made it through, and she is thankful that we are praying for her daughter, who is battling divorce, custody of 2 kids, as well as depression. Amanda Mathias is very sick, and she needs our prayers. Amara's mom at North City Baptist Church needs prayers for a hip issue. Roland Carrier will be operated on for a blockage this week in arteries in his neck. Steph would like prayers for her husband Andy, who is an alcoholic. It's affecting their marriage, and it's affecting her thought life. Angela and her husband Jeff need prayers. Jeff needs to get saved, and Angela is asking prayers for wisdom and strength so that she can model a biblical Christian wife to her unsaved husband. Amen. Eminem is asking prayers for Tim Kelly, who was in a major car accident and has traumatic brain injury. Karen says, please pray for my sister's neighbor. The family was in a really bad car accident, and the mom is in critical condition, unconscious, and their 9-year-old daughter did not make it. The mother, who is still in a coma, does not know that. And that is just, it's terrifying, terrifying. Shannon Kay, please pray for me and everybody on the NTEB ministry team, and for all the souls that are touched by this ministry. Amen. And Shannon also says, please, I have an unspoken prayer as well. Heavenly Father, for all these prayers and for the unspoken prayers of our hearts, we thank you, we praise you, we come before you, and we ask you to work and move in a mighty way. And Father God, we ask you to heal, we ask you to forgive, we ask you to restore, we ask you to provide, we ask you to do everything, Lord, that we need done, because you're our everything. You're our provider, our savior, our advocate, our judge, our redeemer, our counselor, our banker, our lawyer. You are everything, Lord. You are our all in all, and we come before you, Lord, with these prayers and these praises and these petitions, and ask you to work and move for your glory, for our good, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, everybody, welcome to tonight's open forum. We got a lot of really good questions here. I'm just going over the list and wondering where to begin first. Jeanette and Bob from Wisconsin, let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. What is baptism for the dead? In 1 Corinthians 15, I have never heard a good explanation of it. Well, hopefully tonight you will. So turn to 1 Corinthians 15 and let's take a look at what Paul says is baptism for the dead. Now, if you know anything about Mormonism, you know that they do something called baptism for the dead. The Mormons were the people that started Ancestry.com. And the reason why they did that, they started that website service, and a lot of people use it. And a lot of people are really, they get to find out some really great information about their long-lost relatives. But why would the Mormons start Ancestry.com? Why are they the group that is so concerned about genealogical history? Because in Mormonism, they believe that after somebody dies, you can baptize that person, and in the afterlife, that person can actually become a Mormon. Now, you know that that's not true. You know that that's nonsense. But what do they base it on? Well, they base it on 1 Corinthians 15. And let's read let's just read verse 29. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 29. Paul says, else what shall they do which are baptized for the dead if the dead rise not at all? Then why are they then baptized for the dead? And why stand we in jeopardy every hour? I protest by your rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord. And Paul says, I die daily. So what is Paul talking about? Well, turn to Romans chapter 6. Turn to Romans chapter 6 and let's read verses 1 through... Wow. Well, it's a lot. It's almost the entire chapter. Let's read verses 1 through 11 on Romans chapter 6 and you're going to get the idea. You're going to get the answer to this question about three or four verses in. Romans 6, 1, Paul says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were, here it is, baptized into his death? What is baptism a figure of? It is going from death to life. The ironic part is, you are alive, but spiritually you are counted as dead before God. And Paul says, know ye not that as many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? And then he goes to explain this. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Now, how many times have you been to a church baptism and you heard the pastor, they baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and in the Holy Spirit, and what do they say? They say, we are buried with him in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. And that's exactly what baptism is. Baptism is a figure of dead people. It's a baptism for the dead. You are spiritually dead, but then you become alive in Christ. Let's keep reading. Verse 5, Romans 6, 5. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. And then Paul goes on to say in verse 11, likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, can you see where the Mormons would take something like that and create something that is a complete perversion and call it the baptism for the dead, where they're actually baptizing physically dead people? You can't baptize a physically dead person. Baptism for the dead is spiritual baptism. Your physical body going down into the water and coming up again, that same body is going to go in the trash when you die. That water doesn't do anything to your physical body, but it is a baptism of the dead for the dead. Before I got saved, I was alive, but I was dead unto God. When I got saved, I became dead unto the world, but alive unto Jesus Christ. And so, when we read in 1 Corinthians 15, we read, Paul says about the else, what shall they do which are baptized for the dead, if the dead rise not at all? Well, let me tell you something. I'm a dead man, and I'm fully anticipating rising in the first resurrection, and so are every single one of you who have been born again. The reason why you have to be born again is because your first birth is no good. You need a second birth. And when you get that second birth, you become alive unto God through Jesus Christ. Before that second birth, you are dead unto God. Even though physically you're walking, you're talking, you're making money and going to the ball game and listening to music and doing all that stuff, you look alive, but you're not alive. And so that's what baptism for the dead is. And it has nothing to do with Mormonism, and it has everything to do with a sinner getting saved and becoming dead unto sin and alive unto God through Jesus Christ. April has a question. Get Matthew chapter 7 in one hand and get John 7:24 in the other hand. So let's read Matthew chapter 7, and let's read verses 1 through 5. Matthew 7, verses 1 through 5. Judge not, that ye be not judged, for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thine brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, the beam is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite! First cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. And then the verse that she wants us to compare it with is John 7:24. Gospel of John, chapter 7, verse 24. Judge not according to the appearance, but judge righteously. So April wants to know, Matthew 7:1 is saying, don't judge, but it's not really, but I understand what you're saying. And John 7:24 is saying to judge righteously. Well, if you go back to Matthew chapter 7, Jesus is saying, judge not that ye be not judged, for with what judgment ye judged, ye shall be judged. What is he talking about? He is not saying not to judge. He is saying before you judge, take a look in the mirror and make sure that you're not guilty of any of the things that you are judging in other people. Have you ever heard Christians gossiping about other people? And in that gossip, they're talking about other people who are gossiping. right? If you're talking behind somebody's back and you're a Christian, that's unchristian-like behavior. And I try very, very hard to never talk behind somebody's back. I try very, very hard to treat people the way that I would want to be treated. And I heard a preacher say one time, don't forgive somebody else one bit more than God has forgiven you. And that is always stuck in my head, and that is excellent advice. And, you know, the older that you get to be and the longer that you spend time as a Christian, the more compassionate you become towards other people. And what Jesus is saying in Matthew chapter 7, this is kingdom age doctrine. He is saying, make sure that you have your ducks in a row before you go inspecting other people's ducks. Now, when you get to the Gospel of John, well, John is that middle ground between Matthew, Mark, and Luke and the writings of Paul. John doesn't mention the kingdom of heaven. John doesn't mention the tribulation or the time of Jacob's trouble. The Gospel of John kind of has feet in both camps, and a lot of what John has to say is very much in line with what the Apostle Paul wrote. So when we go to John 7:24, and he says, judge not according to the appearance, but judge righteous judgment. Well, what does the Bible say? The Bible says, where is that verse? Where is that verse where Paul says, know ye not that ye shall judge men and angels? Oh, where is that? If somebody could find that verse for me. But the Apostle Paul talks about the day that you and I at the Great White Throne Judgment are going to be judging men and angels. And I can't put my finger on that verse right now. I don't think it's 1 Corinthians 4. No, it's not 1 Corinthians 4, 9. But if you can find that verse, 1 Corinthians 6, 3, let's take a look at that. 1 Corinthians, there it is. 1 Corinthians 6, 1 through 3. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to the law before the unjust, and not before the saints? Do ye not know that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Know ye not that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? So the Christian is absolutely to judge, but in accordance with what Jesus says, in Matthew chapter 7, the Bible says that we are to judge ourselves. Acts 13:46. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, but seeing ye put it from you and judge yourself. No, that's not what I want. Where is that verse? I think it's in 1 Corinthians. I'm striking out with Bible verses tonight. Where is that verse? Hold on. Where is that verse in 1 Corinthians talking about people dead in sleep? Is it 1 Corinthians 14, 12? 1 Corinthians 11. Turn to 1 Corinthians 11. And here, Paul is talking about the Lord's Supper. 1 Corinthians 11, starting in verse 27. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat of this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, And so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. That means that God took them. Verse 31 says, for if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. So I think that you can see from the writings of our Apostle Paul that we need to judge ourselves and make sure that what we're doing, thinking, and saying is in alignment with the Bible. Cheryl H. has a good question. Why will we judge angels? That's a really, really good question. And turn to Revelation chapter 5. Turn to Revelation chapter 5, and I'll show you what we're going to be doing during the millennium. Revelation chapter 5, let's look at verses 9 and 10. This is church age doctrine. This is the church having been raptured in heaven. Verse 9 says, and they sung a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou was slain, and has redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and has made us unto our gods kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. Turn to Revelation chapter 1. Turn to Revelation chapter 1. Let's look at verses 5 and 6. Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 and 6. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth. And this is how we know he's talking about the church age. Unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. That is absolutely church age. And verse 6. Hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Now turn to Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20. By the time that you get to Revelation chapter 20, 1,000 years has gone by since the second coming. And I want you to remember that for that 1,000-year period, we have been operating in the capacity of kings and priests for God, on God's behalf. And we have been administering this for 1,000 literal actual years on the earth in glorified bodies as kings and priests unto God. Now look in Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. And I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which was the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. Now, can you imagine operating as a king or a priest for 1,000 years with the Lord Jesus Christ? Have you ever seen a big courtroom scene? You have the judge sitting on the throne in the middle. You have the jury off to the side. You have the stenographer. You have the bailiff. You have the guards. You have all the attendants. And it is an entire team of people that work inside a courtroom. Well, Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 through 15, shows you the most amazing courtroom drama that you will ever see. And we will be on that team judging men and angels and carrying out judgment based on the decree of the righteous judge who is going to open the books, and he is going to make sure that everybody gets what's coming to them. Now, the Bible doesn't say the graphic details of how all that is going to work out. But I understand what a king does. That's political power. I understand what a priest does. That is interceding on behalf of the people to God. When you combine those two things together, that tells me that we are going to be working to administer the administration of King Jesus, who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords at his second coming. And however that works itself out, that's fine with me. April is asking, will the new earth be like it is now? No. The new earth is going to be like the Garden of Eden, and it's going to be perfect. Now, she is saying, is it going to have jobs and cars and planes? I don't know, but turn to Revelation chapter 22. Turn to Revelation chapter 22, and I know this much. I know that there's still going to be nations, and there's still going to be kings, and there's still going to be a world system, but it's not going to be the type of world system that we have right now. The Bible says this, that the whole world lieth in wickedness. The whole world lieth in wickedness. Do you think God is simply going to recreate that? Turn to 1 John 5:19. 1 John 5:19. And we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. And we know that the Son of God is come, amen, and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true. And we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Are there going to be cars and buses and trains? I don't think so. There's going to be nothing that could cause pollution. So if you're going to have motor vehicles, you're going to have vehicles that work on completely clean energy. There's going to be nothing. Shannon said, I can't see man's vanity on the new earth. And that's a pretty good way of looking at it. You're still going to have people, but you're not going to have human nature, because we're all going to be part of the divine. Even the human beings that made it through everything, they are human beings that will be washed clean, and nobody will ever have a bad thought or a wicked thought. You can think anything you want to think. You can do anything you want to do, and it's going to be the right thing, because everything will be conformed to the image of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And with that, we have to take our first break of the night. We'll be right back after this.
The Bible says, my king is the king of the Jews. He's the king of Israel. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. represented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captive. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he purifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. He's the key to knowledge. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is lighter. I wish I could describe him to you. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. Well, you can't get him out of your mind. You see, you can't get him off of your head. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. Yeah!
Amen, amen, and we are back. That was a really, really good first half hour in the open forum. We got off to a really, really good start, and I'm grabbing your questions in the chat room as I see them, and I just saw Brian's question. I got that. I got that question. Okay, let's move on. Let's talk about this morning's sermon. Get 2 Samuel 24 in one hand and get 1 Chronicles 21 in the other hand. Let's get 2 Samuel 24 in one hand and let's get 1 Chronicles 21 in the other hand. Now, please post for me 2 Samuel 24, 1. And 1 Chronicles 21, 1, back to back. excuse me. Please post for me 2 Samuel 24, 1 and 1 Chronicles 21, 1, back to back, please. 2 Samuel 24, 1 says, "And again, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he moved David against them to say, 'Go number Israel and Judah.'" So 2 Samuel 24, 1, we have the Lord kindling his anger against Israel. And the verse says that it's the Lord that moves David to number the people. But when you get to 1 Chronicles 21, 1, that verse says, "And Satan stood up against Israel and provoked David to number Israel." So when they post those two verses in the chat room side by side, you'll be able to see what looks like a very clear contradiction. 2 Samuel 24, 1 says that it's the Lord that moved David to number Israel. And 1 Chronicles 21, 1 says that it is Satan who stood up against Israel and provoked David to number Israel, and Judah. So which is it? Did the Lord do it or did Satan do it? Well, there's a relatively easy answer to that question. This is not a contradiction at all. Turn to Isaiah chapter 10. Turn to Isaiah chapter 10, and I'll show you that both those verses are absolutely gospel truth. Isaiah chapter 10, God has a pit bull, and that pit bull is on a leash. And that pit bull operates at the pleasure of his owner. Isaiah 5, Isaiah 10, verses 5 and 6. O Assyrian, the rod of mine anger, and the staff in their hand is mine indignation. I will send him against an hypocritical nation, and against the people of my wrath will I give him a charge to take the spoil and to take the prey and to tread them down like the mire of the streets. You see what Isaiah 10 verses 5 and 6 are telling you? That God uses Satan to judge his people. David said, like in Job, exactly like in the book of Job. Turn to Job chapter 1. Turn to Job chapter 1. Starting in verse 6, Job 1:6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, doth Job fear God for naught? Hast thou not made an hedge about him and about his house and about all that he has on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. But put forth thine hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, go get him. Behold, all that he hath is in thy power, only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Now do you understand what you're reading in 2 Samuel 24:1 and 1 Chronicles 21:1? Both those verses are absolutely true. God did move Israel and King David to number the people, and he used Satan to do it. And both those verses are showing you both sides of the same coin. Jax is asking, is Satan still going to and fro? Yes, he is. He does not get cast out until Revelation chapter 12. And we are not in Revelation chapter 12. We are not in Revelation chapter 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, or 4. We are at the end of Revelation chapter 3. So Satan is still going to and fro. So 2 Samuel 24:1 and 1 Chronicles 21:1 are in complete harmony with each other. Now, let's get to the second question. Let's get to the second seeming contradiction. Turn to 1 Chronicles 21, and this is the one that really gets everybody. Turn to 1 Chronicles 21, and look at verses 24 and 25. 1 Chronicles 24, 1 Chronicles 21, verses 24 and 25. And King David said to Ornan, nay, but I will verily buy it for the full price, for I will not take that which is thine for the Lord, nor offer burnt offerings without cost. So David gave to Ornan for the place 600 shekels of gold by weight. And I see more questions coming in. If you guys could try and time it so that you're asking the new questions when I'm done answering the previous ones, that would be fantastic. Thank you. So 1 Chronicles 21, verses 24 and 25 show you that David gave to Ornan for the place 600 shekels of gold by weight. Now turn to 2 Samuel 24 and let's look at verse 24. 2 Samuel 24, 24. And the king said unto Araunah, "Nay, but I will surely buy it of thee at a price. Neither will I offer burnt offerings unto the Lord my God of that which doth cost me nothing." So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. Now, this is another one of those places where critics of the King James Bible have a field day. Because in 1 Chronicles 21, David is buying the place for 600 shekels of gold. But in 2 Samuel 24, 24, he is buying the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. Now the key is found in 1 Chronicles 21, verse 25. So David gave to Ornan for the place 600 shekels of gold by weight. Do you remember where the threshing floor is? Do you think he's only buying the threshing floor? Have you ever wondered how big Solomon's temple was? Do you think that all of Solomon's temple would fit on a threshing floor? No, no, no. 1 Chronicles 21, David is buying he's buying all the land. He's buying the place. And that is a very large area. And he is spending 600 shekels of gold by weight. And he is buying the place. 1 Chronicles 21, 25. In 2 Samuel 24, 24, in addition to buying the place, he is buying the threshing floor and he's buying the oxen. Now, doesn't it make sense that if he's buying all that land, that Solomon's temple, the entire Temple Mount, don't you think that would be a lot more expensive than just 50 shekels of silver? He bought a really large piece of land, and he paid 600 shekels of gold by weight, and he bought the entire field, and he bought the threshing floor, and he bought the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. Is that a contradiction? That is not a contradiction at all. Is that easy to figure out? Well, it all depends. The Greek scholars and the Hebrew scholars can't seem to figure it out. One of the reasons why they can't figure it out, turn to 2 Timothy 2:15. Turn to 2 Timothy 2:15. And I'll show you one of the reasons why the scholars can't figure out stuff like this. Because they don't have the right book. 2 Timothy 2:15. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, if you don't have a King James Bible, you don't have that verse. Why do I say that? 2 Timothy 2:15 in the ESV, which is the current Bible du jour, it's the Bible that everybody wants. 2 Timothy 2:15 in the ESV, do your best, no study, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. Is handling and dividing the same thing? No, it is not. Is it close? No, it is not. How about 2 Timothy 2:15 in the NIV? 2 Timothy in the 2:15 in the NIV. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth. You know what that is? That's a bunch of crap, is what that is. Somebody wrote to me yesterday and they said, I really appreciate your Bible programs and I've donated to your causes, but you seem to be a little bit obsessed about the King James Bible. Well, well, I absolutely am. But why? Because the other versions destroy God's word. If you don't have a King James Bible, you don't have a command to study the book from your apostle. Do you realize that? It removes the word study. It removes rightly dividing. There is right division and there is wrong division. So one of the reasons why the Greek and Hebrew scholars are unable to figure out these contradictions between 1 Chronicles 21 and 2 Samuel 24 is because they have no command to study. They have no command to rightly divide. So they just have to appeal to their own intellect. They have to appeal to their own scholarship instead of appealing to the source of absolute truth, which is the King James Holy Bible. And am I a little bit obsessed with the King James Bible? Well, yeah, absolutely am. And until you can come up with a better reason for me not to be obsessed by it, that's just the way it's going to be. Because everybody else, the Greek and Hebrew scholars, they're stealing your Bible. The King James Bible gives you God's preserved truth. There's only one place in the writings of Paul that commands you to study and rightly divide. And every single one of the modern versions removes that command. And my Bible keeps it in. Even the New King James says, be diligent to present yourself approved to God. It does not tell you to study. So, we're going to stick with the King James because that is where the truth is. All right, let's take another question. What was Katie's question? Let me see if I can find that question. Where is Katie's question? Katie, if you just want to repost that question again, it was something about Revelation 20, verse 3. Oh, where is that question? Let's turn to Revelation chapter 20, verse 3. Katie was asking something about a timeline. And I see Aunt Nancy's question. We're going to get to that next. I absolutely see you there. Revelation chapter 20, verse 3. Let's see if I can reconstruct her question from memory. Oh, yeah. I remember her question now. Katie wants to know about being loosed a little season. Let's read Revelation chapter 20, verses 1 through 3. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. And cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. No need to guess what a little season is. Look down in verse 7 and John will define what a little season is. Verse 7 says, "And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, to the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up upon the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that was that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever." So when the 1,000 years are over, Jesus Christ is going to let Satan out, and he has one more job that God needs him to do. And he is going to send Satan out to every place on the face of the earth that has just lived for 1,000 years under perfect peace and righteousness under Jesus Christ. And he's going to go and sniff out all the fakers, all the pretenders, all the posers, all the Christians in name only. And what he's going to do is he's going to whisper in their ear that you can take him. Yeah, he's been on that throne for 1,000 years. But if we all just band together, we can get him and we can take him down. And what happens? One last global military campaign. This is the Battle of Gog and Magog. It takes place after the 1,000 years are done. A lot of the times on Facebook, I'll see people talking about, look what Russia said. Get ready for the Battle of Gog and Magog. You don't ever have to get ready for the Battle of Gog and Magog, because that battle cannot take place until the 1,000 years are over. And so, to get to Katie's question, how long will Satan be loosed to raise up this army? Well, just guessing, it looks like it would be a couple of weeks to a couple of months. And it looks like from verse 7 to verse 10 that a literal physical military army is going to be raised up. That's going to take a couple of weeks at the very least, probably take a couple of months. And Jesus Christ releases Satan for the express purpose of raising this army. And the army is going to be made up of people who pretend to love Jesus Christ, but they don't. And Jesus is going to flush them all out. And every single person who harbors hate for the Lord, turn to Zephaniah chapter 3. Zephaniah chapter 3. It is God that gathers the nations in their rebellion to destroy them. Zephaniah 3:8. Therefore, wait ye upon me, saith the Lord, until the day that I rise up to the prey. For my determination is to gather the nations, that I may assemble the kingdoms, to pour upon them mine indignation, even all my fierce anger. For all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. Now, why would God do that? Look at the very next verse, Zephaniah 3:9. For then will I turn to the people a pure language, that they may all call upon the name of the Lord to serve him with one consent. So God allows Satan one more time to go out into the world and flush out the fakers. April is asking, will there be Bibles during the 1,000 years? Maybe, maybe not, but you're not really going to need a Bible during that time period. Let me find the verse that talks about 10 men taking hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew. 10 men. Zechariah 8. Turn to Zechariah chapter 8. And let's look at verse 23. No, let's start in 20. Zechariah chapter 8, verses 20 through 23. This is talking about the millennium. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, it shall yet come to pass that there shall come people and the inhabitants of many cities, and the inhabitants of one city shall go to another, saying, let us go speedily to pray before the Lord, and to seek the Lord of hosts, I will go also. Yea, many people and strong nations shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem, and to pray before the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, in those days it shall come to pass that 10 men shall take hold out of all languages of the nations, even shall take hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew, saying, we will go with you, for we heard that God is with you. There's going to be no more need for a prophet either. I think it's Zechariah that says that if you claim to be a prophet during the millennium, you're going to get killed. You're going to get absolutely killed if you claim to be a prophet during... turn to Zechariah chapter 13. Turn to Zechariah chapter 13. And let's look at verses 4 through 6. Zechariah chapter 13, verses 4. No. Zechariah 13, 3. Let's start in 3. Zechariah 13, 3. Again, talking about the millennium. And it shall come to pass that when any shall yet prophesy, then his father and his mother that begat him shall say unto him, thou shalt not live, for thou speakest lies in the name of the Lord. And his father and his mother that begat him shall thrust him through when he prophesieth. And it shall come to pass in that day, when Jesus is on the throne, that the prophet shall be ashamed every one of his vision, when he hath prophesied, neither shall they wear a rough garment to deceive. There's going to be no prophets during the millennium. You're going to have kings and priests, but no prophets, because the Lord is going to be there. And with that, we have to take our last break of the night. You guys are asking some really good questions. We'll be right back after this.
Lord, you are the storm, you're always enough, always enough. Your love is peace to the broken, faith for the widow, hope for the orphan, strength for the weak. Your love is the anthem of nations, rings out through the ages. Always enough for me. You keep my heart in perfect peace. My life is in
back for the last half an hour of tonight's open forum question and answer, and you guys are on fire tonight with your questions, and I love it, and I hope you guys are getting a blessing from it as well. We're talking about some deep stuff, some fun stuff, and we are comparing mountains of scripture with scripture, and I just love doing that. It's like a really good workout at the gym. If we don't get to your question tonight, I have grabbed and captured most of them in a Word document. Whatever we don't cover tonight, we will cover in part three, Lord willing, on Wednesday night. So if we don't cover your question tonight, never fear. We will cover it, Lord willing, Wednesday night. So Samuel has a good question. Turn to the book of Hebrews, chapter 11. turn to the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, and Samuel wants to know why Samson is in the heroes of the faith in Hebrews, chapter 11. So let's take a look. Let's start Hebrews 11:30, and let's go to verse 34. Hebrews 11:30-34. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believe not, when she had received the spies with peace. And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon, and of Barak, and of Samson, there he is, and of Jephthah, of David also, and Samuel, and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, and turned to flight the armies of the aliens. So the question is, Samson, he was a bad boy. Why is Samson mentioned in the heroes of the faith when he lost the Holy Spirit? Well, that is true. He did lose the Holy Spirit, but guess what? He got it back. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Turn to Judges chapter 16. Turn to Judges chapter 16. We all know the story of Samson and Delilah, and she's trying to figure out the source of his power. What Delilah does not know is that Samson has the vow of a Nazarite. He can't eat grapes, he can't drink wine, and he cannot cut his hair. And finally, she gets it out of him, and he reveals his secret. Up to this point, he's kind of enjoying toying with her. And this is a type of a saved Christian playing around with sin and playing around with the world. And then he becomes so confident and so cocky, he actually tells her the source of his strength. Look at Judges 16:16. And it came to pass when she pressed him daily with her words and urged him so that his soul was vexed unto death, that he told her all his heart and said unto her, there hath not come a razor upon mine head, for I have been a Nazarite unto God from my mother's womb. If I be shaven, then my strength will go from me, and I shall become weak like any other man. And when Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the lords of the Philistines, saying, come up this once, for he has showed me all his heart. And then the lords of the Philistines came up to her and brought money in their hand. And she made him sleep upon her knees, and she called for a man, and she caused him to shave off the 7 locks of his head, and she began to afflict him, and his strength went from him. Look at verse 20, a terrifying position. And she said, Judges 16:20, the Philistines be upon thee, Samson. And he woke out of his sleep and said, I will go out as at other times before and shake myself. And he wist not that the Lord was departed from him. So now you would think that this would be the end of the story. And if the story ended here, Samson would not be listed in the heroes of the faith in Hebrews chapter 11. But let's keep reading to see what happened. The Philistines took him in verse 21 and put out his eyes and brought him down to Gaza and bound him with fetters of brass, and he did grind in the prison house. Howbeit, the hair of his head began to grow again after he was shaven. So what's happening? God is giving Samson time to repent. Now, he's never going to get out of the prison house. He's at the last days of his life. But now God is more concerned with Samson's eternity than he is with Samson's life on earth. And God, in his mercy and in his grace, he allows the hair on Samson's head to grow again. And that strength from the Lord begins to return unto him. Now, look at what Samson says in verse 28. They're mocking him. They're getting drunk and they're poking him with a stick. They have blinded him. They have poked out his eyes. Samson could have been bitter. He could have been angry. He could have been focused on what he had lost. But Samson, in his last moments, with his hair growing back, his strength returning, he says to God, "Let me give you glory one more time." And Judges 16:28, and Samson called unto the Lord and said, "O Lord God, remember me." And in the belly of the whale, God remembered Jonah. Amen. I'm going to get to preaching here. And said, "O Lord God, remember me, I pray thee, and strengthen me. I pray thee only this once, O God, that I may be at once avenged of the Philistines for my two eyes." And Samson took hold of the two middle pillars upon which the house stood, and on which it was borne up, of the one with his right hand and the other with his left. And Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." And he bowed himself with all his might. Now the Holy Spirit of God has come back and given him that great power. And the house fell upon the lords and all the people that were therein. So the dead which he slew at his death were more than they which he slew in his life. Are you starting to see why Samson is mentioned in the heroes of the faith? Yeah, he screwed up, but he got back on track. He said, "God, forgive me. Give me back your strength. Give me back your spirit. Let me do one more job, one more time." And he died giving God the glory, and the Holy Spirit returned to him after he had left. Turn to Psalm 51. Turn to Psalm 51. Let me show you one of the greatest people in the entire Old Testament. I'm going to show you a man so great that the Bible says he is a man after God's own heart. A man so great that when Jesus Christ returns in Revelation 19, Luke 1:32 says that he is going to sit on this man's throne. Well, that guy is pretty good. Except he had a bad couple of years. Psalm 51:1. Psalm 51:1. To the chief musician, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet came unto him after he had gone into Bathsheba. "Have mercy on me. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin, for I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight." Really, David? You had sex with another man's wife and you assassinate her husband? And you have only sinned against God? Well, technically speaking, that's correct. "Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest." What is David doing? He's repenting before God. He does not have eternal security. He is not sealed unto the day of redemption. He can lose the Holy Spirit, just as Samson lost the Holy Spirit, but he got him back. Look what David says in Psalm 51, verses 10 through 12. Psalm 51, 10 through 12. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. You see what David's doing? He's not playing games with God. He is asking God to forgive him and to restore him. God is not obligated to do that. You know, in the law of Moses, there was two things that there was no sacrifice for. If you intentionally murdered somebody else, and if you committed adultery, there was no sacrifice that would cover those sins. David knew that he was in big trouble. So what did he do? Just like we read about this morning, when he numbered the people of Israel, and his seer comes to him and says, well, you got to have one of these three things, pick one. David throws himself upon the mercy of the Lord. And by the time it's all said and done, David had purchased the threshing floor, the oxen, and the entire Temple Mount. So we see that with Samson, he is in the heroes of the faith because, yes, he lost the Holy Spirit, but he got the Holy Spirit back. King David sinned, grievously sinned. His sin covered a couple of years before he recovered himself. God gave him grace, mercy, and time to repent, and David did. But now let me show you somebody. Now let me show you somebody who loses the Holy Spirit and does not get the Holy Spirit back. Turn to 1 Samuel chapter 15. Turn to 1 Samuel chapter 15. And let me show you something that King Saul did that caused him to lose the Holy Spirit, and he never got it back. Samuel said also unto Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint thee to be king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore hearken thou unto the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, I remember that which Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way when he came up from Egypt. And 1 Samuel 15:3 says, now go and smite Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have, and spare them not, but slay both man and woman, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and ass. And Saul gathered the people together and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 footmen and 10,000 men of Judah. And we're running out of time, so I'll just get to what I'm trying to tell you. Verse 9, 1 Samuel 15:9. But Samuel and the people spared Agag, and the best of the sheep and the oxen and of the fatlings, and the lambs and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them. But everything that was vile and refuse, they destroyed utterly. Now, was that what God told Saul to do? God said to Saul, Amalek did much damage to my people. Now, I want you to go and pay him back. Did Saul do that? No, he did not do that. And if you were to read the rest of 1 Samuel 15, you will see very, very clearly that Saul's heart was not right with God. He did not do what God told him to do, and he didn't repent. He just continued to make excuses. Now turn to 1 Samuel 16. Turn to 1 Samuel 16. And I'll show you the Holy Spirit departing from Saul. And the Holy Spirit never comes back. 1 Samuel 16, 12 through 14. 1 Samuel 16, 12 through 14. And he sent and brought him in. Now he, David, was ruddy, and withal of a beautiful countenance and goodly to look at. And the Lord said, Arise, anoint him, for this is he. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. For the rest of his days, King Saul would be troubled by an evil spirit from the Lord. God's Holy Spirit went to David instead. So I just gave you three examples. I showed you Samson. He had the Holy Spirit, lost the Holy Spirit, but got him back. King David, he did things that would absolutely qualify him to not have God's Holy Spirit. But God had mercy on him and didn't take his Holy Spirit from him. And then we see King Saul. Then we see King Saul, who does not get God's Holy Spirit back. April is asking, how come then God forgave some and not others? Well, in the examples that I gave you, David repented before the Lord, and God had mercy on him and didn't take his Holy Spirit away. Samson, he screwed around with Delilah. He did exactly what he wasn't supposed to do. But after he lost the Holy Spirit, his heart returned back to God. And God gave him his hair back, gave him his strength back, and gave him his spirit back. But King Saul never repented. King Saul never wanted to change. He never wanted to get right. So God let him die by going to the witch at Endor and calling up an evil spirit. And then the next day he dies in battle. Now, was God playing favorites with Samson, David, and Saul? He liked one more than he liked the other? Not at all. King Saul had every chance to get it right. He didn't want to. King David had every chance to do the right thing, and he did do the right thing. Samson did the wrong thing. He lost it, but God gave him opportunity to get it back. And he did. Now, of course, you have to understand this dispensationally. Nobody in the Old Testament was sealed unto the day of redemption. You can't lose the Holy Spirit. You can't lose your salvation because of Ephesians chapter 1, verses 12 through 14, and Ephesians chapter 4. That says that we are sealed unto the day of redemption. But these are the type of things that you come up with when you rightly divide the Bible and you are dispensationally correct, and everything begins to fall into place perfectly, absolutely perfectly. I showed you a couple of glaring contradictions in the account of King David buying the threshing floor. Were there any actual contradictions? Not a single one. But if you're a Greek scholar or a Hebrew scholar, you don't know how to rightly divide the Bible. And worse than that, you don't have a Bible that you think is God's preserved word. You think they're all the same. And so God says, is that how you want to look at my word? I'll just make sure that you don't learn a whole lot of it. And that's why here on this program, we do have God's Word. We have the King James Holy Bible. The Bible says where the word of a king is, there is power. And if you have the word of a king, you have that power. If you don't, then you don't. And with that, we've come to the end of our time for tonight. Lord willing, we'll see you back here tomorrow, Monday, noon Eastern time, for another edition of the Prophecy News Podcast. We have a good one tomorrow. We're going to talk about Bill Gates and his 242,000 acres of farmland, and we're going to show you what he's growing on that land, and you're not going to like it. You're not going to like it at all. But it's going to be a really, really cool program. Have a good night, everybody. Lord willing, see you here tomorrow.
The preachers are weary. The singers are tired. The church, as we know it, is losing its fire. And some are discouraged from bearing the load, but we must determine to keep pressing on. 'Cause it's just one more soul were to walk down the aisle, it would be worth every struggle. It would be worth singers go sing, and laymen keep sharing that Jesus is King. The angels have gathered, they're surrounding the throne, and they'll start rejoicing for just one more soul. 'Cause it's just one more soul.